In the last session, we learned about how to fix the metrics for the improvement projects for the Six Sigma, and we saw about how we can convert from the voice of customer into CTQs, how we can get metrics from the cost of poor quality, etc. So in this session, we will learn about how we are going to initiate the projects by using the formal documents called the project charter. Because the one of the main activities in the design phase of the Six Sigma project is the preparation of the project charter. The project charter is the formal document issued by the senior management of the company, committing the support for the success of the project and providing resource for the project. So it is very important document to be made for whenever a Six Sigma project is initiated. So by the end of the session, you will be able to build a business case and a project charter, develop project metrics, and perform the financial evaluation and capture the benefits which are going to be get accrued because of the Six Sigma project. So as I told you just now, the one of the very important activity during the design phase of the Six Sigma project is the development and acceptance of the project charter. A project charter is a written document that defines the team's mission, scope of operation, objectives, time frames, and the benefits. And also, we can say that a charter is a commitment for support from the top management with respect to providing the resources for the improvement project. A charter also provides the following advantages. Means once you are making a formal document, and then it eliminates any confusion at the later stage, because most of the time what happens is if a formal document is not made, then the objectives keep on changing once you are progressing along the project, and at the end we may not be very sure whether the project has been successfully completed or not. That is why a formal document is very much necessary to ensure that the baselines are documented properly, and at the end of the process project we are just comparing the achievement to measure whether the project has been successfully completed or not. Also, the project charter will identify the scope of the project so that we will be able to clearly tell which are the processes which are under the scope of the project and which are the processes which are not. It also gives a clear objective for the project team to achieve so that they are very clear about what are the goals they would like to achieve. Since it is a formal document signed by the senior management, the project charter also gives access for the necessary resources for the project. It also identifies what are all the deliverables for the project. It also authorizes the team to collect the relevant data, because you know that in any of the organization, people are very reluctant to share the data. And since data is a very important requirement for the any Six Sigma project, availability of a formal project charter will help in giving authority to the project team to collect the relevant data. And also it approves the time for team members to address problems. Mostly the people are engaged in this projects on a part-time basis, and the availability of this particular project charter will ensure that the people are released on time for doing this project work. So the project charter has got the many key points. So the first one is a business case. A business case is normally a document which shows what are the benefits the project is going to give. The project charter also contains the problem statement, the goal statement, the project scope or the boundaries, the roles of the team members, the milestones for the deliverables, and what are all the resources required. So these are all the key requirements for a project charter. And now we will just see one by one what are all the requirements of these areas. So for the business case, it is actually a short summary of why the project is taken up for improvement. Because there should be a strategic reason for the project to be taken, and it should align with the strategic reason of the company. If a project is not aligned to the strategic objectives of the company, then there is always a possibility that the project may fail. So a business case should be able to link the objectives of the project to the objectives of the organization, so that the project is getting support from all the layers of the organization. So the general reason why a business case is taken up is the financial justification. So the company is going to send some money on this project, and whether spending that much of money is really justifiable. So normally a project is undertaken either for a design of a new product or a process, or to redesign the existing product or process so that the performance is improved. So the outcome of a business case will be the benefits, whatever we are going to get out of the project is properly documented, and we are able to clearly tell what are all the hard savings the project is going to generate. Hard savings means the savings which can be measured in terms of hard cash. And in some projects there may be soft saving also, like the customer satisfaction, the employee engagement, etc. These are all some of the soft savings that will be accruing because of the projects. So all these benefits are being captured as a part of the business case, and a proper justification is given for taking up the project in the business case. The next important aspect of the project charter is the problem statement. So this is actually a very important element of the project charter, and most of the Six Sigma projects fail because the problems are not defined properly. Even though as a project leader, most of the green belts or the black belts clearly know about the problem, if the problem statement is not written correctly, then there is always a possibility that the problem is understood in an entirely a wrong way, and the project is taking a wrong direction. So it is always very important to capture the exact problem statement. So a problem statement should clearly capture what is the issue, and then for how long the particular issue is happening, and what is the current level of that particular issue. Say for example, in a company, the company feels that the rejections are very heavy, and then they are measuring the rejections on a weekly basis, and they find that for the last 6 months, the average rejection has been around 12% against their normal 6% which has been recorded in the previous years. So that means the rejection has increased by 6%. So the problem statement for this particular project can be: the rejections in the process is very high at 12% based on the data collected for the last 6 months. So while we are framing the problem statement, we'll have to be very clear that we should not assume any reasons and give that as a part of the problem statement. So for example, if you say that the rejection has increased to 12% because of inexperienced operators, so that means the reason for the problem is known, and then that becomes a special cause. And as I have told in the first session, the special cause variations are not addressed by the Six Sigma projects. So that is the reason. If the reasons are already known, then the proper actions can be taken without the help of any Six Sigma tools or methodology. Because you know that spending money on Six Sigma projects is very huge, because a lot of people are involved in data collection, analysis and improvement activities. And until and unless the project is able to generate so much of revenue, it is not advisable to take the silly problems as a Six Sigma project. So normally the problem is taken up as a Six Sigma project only if the reasons are not known. So we'll have to be very careful that in the problem statement we do not mention about what are the causes for the problem. So as I told you, the ideal problem statement will be the rejections as at 12% for the last 6 months. So Then we talk about what is the project scope. So whenever we talk about the project scope, then we'll have to be very clear about which process we are talking about. Because as I told you in the previous session, in a company, there are a lot of systems and a lot of processes which are happening simultaneously. So it is always very important to exactly pinpoint the process on which we are going to do the project. Otherwise, again, if the scope is not defined properly, then the project either may be, the scope may be very high or the scope may be too low. In both the cases, the probability of the project ending as a failure is very high. So the scoping of the project is very, very important. So we will have to clearly identify the start and end of the process which is taken up for improvement through the Six Sigma methodology, and also whether for the same process the different locations where this particular process is happening are also included in the scope, or the process which is happening on only a particular location is taken up for improvement. So the scope, both in terms of lateral and longitudinal, is very, very important. Then the goal statement. So like how problem statement is important, equally important is the goal statement. So in the goal statement, we will have to set the objectives of what we want to achieve and when do we want to achieve. So in the problem statement, we are clearly told these are the problems, these are the issues. And in the goal statement, we will have to clearly say that we want to improve from here to here. In the example, whatever I gave, the ideal goal statement will be we want to reduce the rejections from 12% to 8% by July 2018. So in that case, we clearly know what is the problem, that is the rejections, then what is the baseline or the current level, that is 12%, and then where do we want to go, we want to reach 8%, and when do we want to do, that is July 2018. So these are all the different elements that should be present as a part of the goal statement. Then we also need to specify what are the milestones of the deliverables, important deliverables of the projects. So normally we know that in a Six Sigma project we have these five phases, the define, measure, analyze, improve and control. So we'll have to give a clear timeline of when each of these particular phases are going to be completed. Normally a Six Sigma project is have a duration of around 4 to 6 months. The define phase may run for maybe around 20 to 30 days. The measure phase will run for around 45 to 60 days, because we need to collect a lot of data and the data accuracy also needs to be ensured. So that is why a measure phase takes a longer time. Then analyze phase may be for a period of maybe around 30 days. And again, we may spend around 60 to 90 days in the improve phase, since we'll have to find out the solutions, implement those solutions, and certify that the solutions have been effectively implemented. So implementation phase also will have a larger duration, and the control phase may run for around 30 days. So overall, a project may run for 4 to 6 months. And if a project is prolonging more than 8 months or 10 months, that means maybe the project has got stuck up somewhere, and then the probability of that particular project being successfully completed is very thin. Then as a part of the project charter, we also identify what are the different resources required. So the resources required in terms of the qualified people, what is the machine time required, what are the different equipments, any phones and faxes, machineries, any computers, labs, office space, utilities, human resources, etc. So this has to be meticulously planned so that these resources are available at the right time for doing the project work.